Surely God is in this place. Help me notice. Welcome, Fort Massey. Thank you to everyone who is joining us here in the sanctuary and also online. We are glad you are with us. Everyone is valued, needed, and belongs. My name is Sharon Ballantyne, and I am the Intentional Interior Minister here at Fort Massey United in Halifax. Welcome to worship for September 18th, 2022, Creation Time, this 15th Sunday after Pentecost. Today we are acknowledging that Wednesday is the International Day of Peace, and you'll notice the peace theme throughout our service today. We hope that this time will be a blessing to all of us, nourishment for our souls, all who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and to all who mourn and feel pain each day, to all who fail and need strength, to all who are trying to turn things around and in need of God's love. This community of faith opens wide her doors with welcome from Jesus Christ. And as we gather in faith, open to God's message to each of our hearts today, let's discover, let's listen to what God's message is as we each walk our own path of peace. And I invite Jenny now to play some quiet music as Lily and her helper come forward to light our Christ candle. If you have a candle at home, I invite you to light it now or just hold the light of Christ in your heart. In this creation time, in this season of Pentecost, we light the Christ candle, inviting us to turn inward. Peace, peace, peace. Feel God's peace. Christ's light shine. Here in Halifax, we are located on the Mi'kma'ki, the ancestral unceded territories of the Mi'kmaq. We acknowledge this land and First Peoples here and wherever people are joining us from virtually as we continue in our lifelong learning, seeking truth and reconciliation. We seek to live in peace and friendship with all people. May it be so. I invite you now to join me responsibly in the call to worship. The words are on the screen and also printed in your bulletin. God be with you. In this creation time, we gather, honoring Creator and creation. We come as peace seekers and peace bearers. We open wide our doors of welcome. And I invite us to just settle in where we are, being comfortable as we move ourselves deeper into our seeking of God's presence in our lives. And as we breathe together, I invite you to just breathe in God's mighty presence. And as we release our breath, let it be a time of just letting go, releasing, letting all tension and anxiety and anything that's pulling us away from God just be released into stillness. Let's breathe it in and let out into silence. Creator, we center and ground ourselves, offering gratitude that we are gathered in worship in person and virtually. You offer us such opportunities and promise. Guide us in our choices and our priorities. Help us feel your mighty presence. Fill us with the wonder and awe of your peace and grace. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. And we sing together now, I am walking a path of peace, which is More Voices 221. Christ be with you. And I invite you to greet each other in a sign of peace. Our thanks this morning to Jenny Trites, our music director at the organ and piano, to our choir, to Colleen Esbrooks, our usher this morning, to Carol Dobson, who is doing our PowerPoint, to Cook Ballantyne, who's videoing, and to Kathy Evans and others who have arranged for our lemonade following worship. We hope that you will stay. My message today is called Path of Peace. You're going to find the announcements printed in your bulletin and also in Thursday's newsletter. And here's a few highlights. Our flowers this morning are in loving memory of Captain Angus. Allison McDonald and her siblings, Lindsay and Alan, offer their thanks and appreciation to all of our family of faith for prayers, support, and in celebrating Captain Angus's life. Stories and remembrances are gifts. Thank you. So, have you got your sweet tooth ready? Lily Noor has Girl Guide chocolate mint cookies. Yeah, you know the ones that are the good ones. They are just $5 a box. Create generosity and sharing at 2 for $10 or splurge on 4 for $20. They even freeze well. Those who are going to the Naval Museum on Tuesday for the presentation four of the two paintings and the tour are asked to meet at the designated parking area at the Naval Museum. We'd like to be there for 1:45. Drivers should have received a map from Colleen, and if you might not have a ride sorted out, please do let us know. Wednesday morning at 10 a.m. on my Zoom, which is September 21st, our day of peace, in this creation time, we will have a special gathering. And it's virtual, so please check out the link on the newsletter or get a hold of me and I'll be happy to share it with you. And you can join in by phone or using the internet. Whatever works for you. We hope you'll join us. Next Sunday, everyone is invited to wear orange. We will be wearing orange as part of Orange Shirt Day, which is actually observed on September 30th. Embracing every child matters. Can you speak a language other than English? In preparing for our World Communion Sunday, October 2nd, we are looking for a few people who could read the words of institution during the communion time in a language other than English. So you don't have to be fluent, but if you are able to read in another language, it'll just be a few sentences, that would be fantastic. So if it's you or someone you know, please see Bill Gillis. And I think I heard you out there earlier this morning. Bill, give a wave. Thanks. Looking ahead, Fort Massey is providing food for the Dalhousie Multi-Faith Supper on October 17th. Please see Ian McDonald, who is chair of our outreach, if you have questions. Blessings and our best wishes to all who are celebrating birthdays, anniversaries, or other celebrations this week. I invite you now to please rise and join me in the words of our new creed, and which is our affirmation of faith. The words are in your bulletin and on the screen. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God who is created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Our stewardship second, faithful in small things, faithful in all things. We're all familiar with the phrase, every little bit counts. This could refer to our time, our offering of skills, our learning, our sharing of money, how we support and encourage others, our prayer and devotional practices. Faithful in small things, faithful in all things. As we observe the flower, what parts of the petal are singing to you this morning? We are reminded of all the ways that we give and receive. And according to your comfort, imagine or pretend that you are holding an offering plate. We give of our time, talent, and treasure. And in giving, we receive so much more. Our offering will be received. Thank you.
Peacemaker God, we are called to be faithful in all that we have, in our time, talents, our gifts, and our service. Sometimes, O God, we feel limited. Help us to feel the generosity of our giving as we lift up ourselves and others, as we talk with others, listen and share, as we offer our work in time and talent, and by every manner that we offer service. May our gifts be a blessing to those who had no bed this morning from which to arise, for those who had no breakfast and are hungry this day, for those who have not enough clothes, for those not in safe places. Bless us and these gifts, that all we have and all we are may be used to share your great love here and throughout our world. For we ask it in the name of your Son, Jesus, the Prince of Peace. Amen. Well, our time for our young and our young at heart. Today in our Bible story, Jesus tells another parable, a story, wanting people to understand how important it is to love God. It's kind of a strange story, beginning with two not so very nice people. The manager was making bad choices. He was actually taking money that didn't belong to him. And when his master, his boss, who was also a bit of a shady character, caught him, he fired the manager. The manager got scared, and instead of saying that he was sorry and asking forgiveness, he decided he'd try to cheat his boss some more. And he also hoped that the workers would help him in the future, maybe even giving him a place to stay since he wasn't going to have a job and he didn't really want to work hard. So he came up with this plan to cheat. He asked some workers to change how much they owed the master, the boss. Jesus said that the master thought that the manager was kind of creative in the way that they tried to cheat him like that. But now that doesn't sound very much like what Jesus would teach, that it was good that that guy ripped someone off. But that is, of course, not what Jesus was thinking about. Jesus wanted them to think about the story not in the ways that the manager and his boss were taking advantage of others. Jesus did not support their choices to cheat, to steal, or be mean, but he wanted people to take the part of the story about the manager thinking, planning, being creative, trying to find solutions to problems. Jesus wants everyone to do good things to help each other, to use our brains to help us solve problems, to think and plan, to reach out to others for help. And of course, when we do something wrong, to say I'm sorry and ask forgiveness. We need to be people who do things and take action. Today I'm hoping that everyone in the congregation can help to take some creative action. People have been looking all around our church building here, trying to figure out stuff that we might not need anymore, or that we need to reorganize. We want everyone to come into Fort Massey and feel welcome, and think, this is a nice place to be. Like, when we get our own room messy at home, we tidy it up. Fort Massey has been working on tidying up. Upstairs, there is a bunch of stuff in the upper gym that we would like to donate to people who are coming from the Ukraine, where there's a war going on, and people are not safe. Cliff and I have been taking lots of stuff over to help the Ukrainian families. We want to share what we have. If you can help, and only if it's a safe thing for you to do, after church to bring some stuff downstairs. If it's really raining, we won't put it into our SUV, but if it is raining, If it is raining, we won't put it into our SUV, but if it's not raining, we will. If it is raining, we'll just throw everything into the minister's study for now, and we'll make it over to the Ukrainian store or to a Ukrainian family in the next little while. I also have a little homework. Think about stuff at your house, particularly those things that might be in drawers or boxes or cupboards or closets, tucked away. Is there maybe some stuff that you haven't used in a year, 2 years, 3 years? Maybe you were holding on to it for something special. Maybe the Ukrainian families are that something special. If you have something that you're not using, you don't need anymore, and you think a Ukrainian family might be able to use it, we invite you to bring those donations to the church, and Cliff and I will be happy to take them over for you. Or you can read in the newsletter where to take the stuff yourself. They are not able to take clothing or toys. Thank you for looking around to see if you have something to share. Let's do a repeating prayer. Dear God, thank you for the ways we can use our brains. And make good choices. Thank you for the ways we can be creative. And show our love. Help us to help others. In Jesus' name. Amen. I invite us to say together now the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And it's time to sing again as we sing the familiar hymn, I've Got Peace Like a River, Voices United 577.
Thank you.
excerpts from Mafoe's Tutu Van Herse 22 book, Forgiveness and Reparation, The Healing Journey. We learn more about Ubuntu and paths of peace through forgiveness. Mafoe Tutu Van Herse describes a painful miscommunication that took place during South Africa's truth and reconciliation process. I am sorry. Forgive me, were the words the perpetrator said. I am taking responsibility for what I did and what was done under my command or in my name. But what the victims heard was not the same. They did not hear the words the perpetrators said. They heard the words of the translators instead. Vedasa Veloxo, apologies for that. But that's not the same. The English, I am sorry, wraps the plea in the logic of individuality, and the English, forgive me, underlines the same. What I have done was done only by me, and thus is only my responsibility. This, I am sorry, forgive me. That's all about me. But the old ones, those listening to the translations, heard a different word. Vedasla Uvaksolo means, I ask for peace. I'm going to stop quoting there just for a minute to think about it. I am sorry. Forgive me. If it means, instead, I ask for peace. Continuing. It is Ubuntu apology, and it is about we. I ask for peace, sees our interconnectivity. I am sorry, forgive me, means set me free of the guilt and the shame that has burdened me. Decide to wipe the debt or the slate clean for me. But the old ones heard, I ask for peace, and they offered forgiveness as peace based on Ubuntu reciprocity. They gave their forgiveness as space to plant the seeds of a better future for the whole community. Ubuntu peace is peace between us and peace within each of us. Ubuntu forgiveness is peace that heals. What the old ones heard, that Daisla Uexlo, they heard perpetrators asking for hope for a better we. They heard an appeal for healing for all of us, and in the space between us that is community. They heard an appeal for a healing of the fabric of life. Reparations have made a new place for others to gather. Reparations have started to reveal what it takes for all of us to heal and to step into God's new creation. May that give us reflection. Turning now to our scriptures. Today I'm reading from the Message, from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 16, verses 1 to 13. Jesus said to his disciples, there was once a rich man who had a manager. He got reports that the manager had been taking advantage of his position, running up huge personal expenses. So he called him in and said, what's this I hear about you? You're fired, and I want a complete audit of your books. The manager said to himself, what am I going to do? I've lost my job as manager. I'm not strong enough for a laboring job, and I'm too proud to beg. Ah, I have a plan. Here's what I'll do. Then, when I'm turned out into the street, people will take me into their houses. Then he went at it. One after another, he called in the people who were in debt to his master. He said to the first, how much do you owe my master? He replied, 100 jugs of olive oil. The manager said, here, take your bill. Sit down here, quick now, write 50. To the next he said, and you, what do you owe? He answered, 100 sacks of wheat. He said, take your bill, write in 80. Now here's a surprise. The master praised the crooked manager. And why? Because he knew how to look after himself. Streetwise people are smarter in this regard than law-abiding citizens. They're on constant alert, looking for angles, surviving by their wits. I want you to be smart in the same way, but for what is right, using every adversity to stimulate you to creative survival, to concentrate your attention on the bare essentials so you'll live, really live, and not complacency, just get by on good behavior. Jesus went on to make these comments. If you're honest in small things, you'll be honest in big things. If you're a crook in small things, you'll be a crook in big things. If you're not honest in small jobs, who will put you in charge of the store? No worker can serve 2 bosses. He'll either hate the first and love the second, or adore the first and despise the second. You cannot serve both God and the bank. Offered as wisdom for the journey, may we walk in its light. And I invite us to receive this ministry of music. Hear me when I call.
Thank you so much.
Let us pray. Come, Holy Spirit, come that we might receive what you have for us today. Creator, guide us on our paths of peace to serve you. And may the words of my mouth and the thoughts and meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. The manager said to himself, "What am I going to do?" He did not seek forgiveness. He decided he needed to create a future relationship with people for his own self-interest and debt-owing arrangement. Last week, I mentioned the strategy of replacing our negative, judging, harsh thoughts or words with the word joy. In this illustration today, we can look at this manager and express multiple times, "This person is such a joy." This shrewd or crooked manager got creative for the wrong reasons. The master recognized that the manager's ability to think outside the box was a good thing, a strong characteristic. As people of faith, we are asked to apply creativity for the right reasons. As we each ask God, "What am I going to do?" There's probably something you're dealing with right now, and you are prayerfully discerning. What am I going to do? How can we look at our immediate challenges, worries, and problems and fears? You can't serve God and the bank. In Matthew chapter 25, verses 34 to 36, we read, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." It always comes down to how we live our lives, the choices we make. An interviewer went to speak with a man who was celebrating turning 102 years old. The interviewer was no doubt looking for this man's secret to success, or the secret sauce for longevity and living well. At the close of their visit, the interviewer said to the older man, "I hope to get to visit you next year when you turn 103. The older man said to the interviewer, "Well, you look healthy enough to me." I think that older person, elements of the centenarian's secret sauce, perhaps prayer, perhaps the joy of living each day, not worrying about the future, but holding tight to this moment, to who he was and who God had called him to be. Peace, contentment, gratitude, family, joy, humor. This centenarian discovered his path of peace. I think he had his answers to what he was going to do each day. Christian author and speaker Corrie Ten Boom, the Dutch watchmaker who, together with her family, hid people of the Jewish faith during World War II, is quoted as saying, "Is prayer your steering wheel or your spare tire?" Corrie's family decided what they were going to do. with a lot of Ubuntu as well, if you ask me. Despite dangers, it was a prayerful path of peace, doing the right thing. In your own path of peace, notice your faithful footprints, taking risks to feed, to clothe, to visit, to care for others, moving us into places of discomfort, uncertainty, risk, but providing the greatest peace we know within us, serving God, helping others, embracing the we is the right thing to do. We do not know that tomorrow, the next day, next week, what it will bring, but we have today. We know that we can't be all things to all people. We can't do everything. We can't rely on the past or the way we used to do things. We also don't want to use excuses to justify our choices. Last week I shared a humorous 10-point no excuses Sunday focus in which a California church shared how they would have something for everyone, trying to address all the needs that people offered as excuses for why they can't make time for God, for their faithful participation in their community of faith. What excuses might get in the way of our own prayer life, our devotions, our spiritual care and guidance, our thoughts, our words and actions, our own paths of peace? If you were able to identify, to share what your personal hallmarks of living faithfully are, that contentment, the path of peace, what might they be? Put another way, if you were mentoring another person, what might you share as your secret to success, or that secret sauce, if you will? Why might Jesus tell such a confusing story as we hear today? Why is our dishonest manager shrewd, even though he's still a sinner, looking out for his own interests? He models behavior that the disciples can emulate then and now. Instead of simply being a victim of circumstances or excuses, he transforms a bad situation into one that benefits him and in some ways others by reducing others' debts. He also creates a new set of relationships based on the vertical relationship between lenders and debtors, the hierarchy, if you will, rooted in monetary exchange, but more on that reciprocal, egalitarian relationship of friends. We choose what we take from the story of our own creativity. We sense the kingdom of God possibilities, breaking barriers of hierarchy. We need each other for the right reasons. We embrace one another in the joy of generous, radical hospitality. Karen C. Brown simplifies this parable message this way. The parable describes the actions and conversation of two bad guys. Jesus did not approve of what the servant did or of the master's compliment. Instead, Jesus was using their outrageous story to make four points. First, Christians should work as hard at doing God's work as the bad servant did at misusing his master's money. Second, we should be generous in sharing our money and our possessions. People who share
have many friends, and having friends makes a person happier than having money or things. Third, if we use our money and things well, generously, God will entrust us with even more exciting and important work. Not necessarily money, but wonderful ways to serve. Fourth, we are not to be greedy. Brown helps us lift up deeper understanding of what it's going to take each of us to walk our path of peace. Jesus challenged us to think about relationships, those just and unjust ones, positions of power, uses of wealth, values, purpose. We work together and walk together the path of peace. Prayer, our steering wheel, confronting our excuses. Ubuntu, faithfully answering, what am I going to do? Serve God. Thanks be to God, and amen. Let us pray. God of unfailing love, Savior to whom we belong, Spirit of truth, you we worship, you we love, you we trust. We offer you the week that is past. You alone know how you have worked in and through our moments and our days. We pray for your transforming power to be present among us and through us in this moment, today, and always, that others may experience your light, your goodness, your truth in our lives. That we might share the spirit of Ubuntu, continue to guide us. Our future is not built in money. It is built in the body, mind, and spirit feeding of relationships. We are a people of faith. Strengthen and nurture us. Help us live each day in gratitude and thanksgiving. Help us to be creative and share what we have, offering peace, hope, and helping hands. There are many joys and concerns that we hold. Receive them, O God, as we offer them in our hearts. Blessed are we, in Jesus' name, amen. And we sing, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace, Voices United 684. Thank you.
Go now, in peace. Let us go forth, walking more lightly on earth, more humbly with all creation, more faithfully caring, with prayer as our steering wheel, and our own answer to what am I going to do? In humility, walk the path of peace. Embrace Ubuntu. God bless you, and amen.
May it be so.
May it be so.